Hi! On the eve of Halloween, I started a series of videos dedicated to the very dawn of chivalry, about great and often terrifying people, from whom the very chivalry that we know has grown. And I'm going to start with a very unusual story, a story of risen from the grave Hastings. Stay tuned! Hastings, well known as Austin, Hastings, Hurston, and Hastings, and alias Alstin, a notable Viking chieftain born in France, famous for his raids in France and Italy. Even more precisely, he became a bloody nightmare for his own homeland and other countries. French chronicles describe him as the most vicious man who ever lived. Hastings made his first raid in 838, when he raided the Somme and Loire, with several ships where he captured and burned the castle of Amboise. In 842, he assembled an even larger fleet for another raid on France. By this time, he had become a leader known for his good fortune, and warriors from all over the world flocked to him. In particular, the son of Ragnar Lodbrok, Bjorn Ironside, also known as the Bear, who was said to be invulnerable in battle. Having made sacrifices to Thor, the Vikings went on the raid. In June 843, Hastings' Drakkars approached Nantes. At first, the inhabitants took the Vikings' ships for merchant ships and barely managed to close the gates, but the robbers knocked them out of a ram and broke into the city, where they killed everyone in a row, men, women, old men, monks and children. Some monks tried to hide in St. Peter's church, but the Vikings rushed inside and killed all the priests and monks, looted the church and burned it down. Together with the loot, Vikings sailed to the island of Noirmoutier, located near the mouth of Loire, which they made their base for raids. They took there all the loot from all lands. In 845, Hastings joined forces with Ragnar, who was going to raid Paris, where they inflicted a crushing defeat on the Franks. King Charles the Bold was forced to pay off the Vikings by paying them 7,000 pounds of silver. Perhaps Ragnar and Hastings would not have stopped there, but an epidemic of dysentery broke out among the warriors, from which many Vikings died and others were greatly weakened. Wherefore, having taken the ransom, the robbers preferred to return. Nevertheless, Hastings found himself at the walls of Paris 10 years later. Charles the Bold, who feared the Normans more than hell, again bought off with 700 pounds of gold and 3,000 pounds of silver. After that, Hastings lost all interest in France. He was attracted not only by the thirst for gold, but also by the thirst for fame. Once Hastings addressed his squad, "All countries in the world are open for us. All of them may see our glory. If I give a bear a Roman crown, then our glory will be spread throughout the world." Of course, he was warmly supported by his warriors. Hastings thoroughly prepared for expedition, he collected 62 ships. They say the Vikings chose a somewhat windy path. At first they were brought to Spain, which was under the rule of Arabs, who didn't like the Vikings' invasion too much. Having lost two ships, Hastings headed south. Having passed the Strait of Gibraltar in 860, the Vikings sacked Algeciras and landed in North Africa, in the Cape Three Forks region. After staying there for a week, they returned to Spain again and then visited the Balearic Islands. Finally, apparently recalled the purpose of our campaign, they headed for the Genoese Gulf. In all likelihood, Hastings himself didn't know where Rome was, so when he once saw a beautiful limestone city on the coast, he delightedly decided that it was Rome. However, this was not Rome. It was a small but rich Italian city of Luna. The inhabitants of Luna, noticing the Vikings, closed the gate and prepared to defend themselves. Realizing that the city could not be taken so easily, Hastings decided to take the city with a trick. He took several people and appeared at the gate, where he appeared before the local count and bishop. Having presented them with rich gifts, he declared that he had no hostile intentions and that a storm had brought him there, so he would leave in a week. Then, pretending to be seriously ill, he expressed a desire to be baptized before death, begging the count and bishop to become his grandparents. They agreed, and in the evening, a baptism was performed at a local cathedral, after which Hastings returned to his ship. The next night, the townspeople were awakened by loud weeping and groaning, and at the morning the ambassadors appeared to announce the death of their leader. Dying, the leader ordered to transfer his gifts to the church and asked to bury him in the city monastery. Having received gracious consent, the ambassador sadly departed. On the day of a funeral, 7 dozen Vikings brought the coffin with the body of a deceased through the gates. Hastin, according to custom, laid in a full combat gear. Warriors with the rich gifts marched ahead. A funeral procession moved to the monastery where the grave had already been prepared. In the monastery, the count and the bishop stood at the very tomb, and after the funeral prayers, when the coffin began to be lowered into the grave, the dead man jumped from the coffin and with one terrible blow beheaded the count and then killed the bishop. Everyone present was numb with horror. Taking advantage of this, 2 Vikings rushed to the doors and locked them. The rest staged a savage massacre. A few minutes later, all nobles of the city who came to the funeral were killed. At the same time, crowds of Normans rushed from the harbor. They killed the guards at the gates, taken aback by surprise, and soon the city fell. As usual in the city, the Vikings began to slaughter everyone, except perhaps the most beautiful women and girls. Having filled up the Drakkar with goods, the Vikings set off from the coast. However, almost immediately they got into a terrible storm, the Vikings had to throw all their loot aboard, including above-mentioned women and girls. When the storm died down, it turned out that only 20 ships remained afloat. Not getting to Rome, Hastin was forced to return. Less dramatic story tells us that after Luna, he sailed down the coast and sank Pisa, and sailing on the river Arno, ravaged Fiesole. And the storm that left him only 20 ships was at Strait at Gibraltar on his way back. In France, the Vikings returned to the old ways. King Charles the Bold finally realized that it was impossible to buy off the insatiable robbers. The problem was not solved, but only devastated the treasury, and the Vikings became more and more greedy and stronger. Wherefore, the king changed his tactics. He began to offer the Vikings not money, but entire counties, in exchange for an oath of allegiance, turning his enemy into powerful allies. So what happened with Hastin, who received the county of Chartres? What happened to him father is not known for certain. According to one source, Hastin was baptized for a second time and remained in France forever, now as a count and a royal vassal. According to another, he sold the county to his former colleague, Gerlon or Theobald, and left the country to the unknown direction. Well, that's it for a Halloween story. Have a nice holiday. Like the video, subscribe if you don't want to miss more. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.